Today here at Tech Yes City, I'm going to be reviewing the 3900 XT and also the 3700 XT for you guys. And straight away out of the bat, AMD, even in their own official notes, are saying that these CPUs have an optimized 7 nanometers versus the previous X counterparts. But another important factor here is that the 3800 and the 3900 XT chips don't include a Wraith Prism cooler, which you usually get on the X counterparts. Another thing too is that the 3600 XT does carry the Wraith Spire cooler, and so they are coming in at the same MSRP pricing as the original X chips. But what is different with these chips inherently? What I've seen here is that AMD in their notes are saying around 200 megahertz higher. And I found this very true for the 3800 XT, but not so much for the 3900 XT. And now for advertised speeds, we got here 3.8 gigahertz all core on the 3900 XT and 4.7 gigahertz single core boost. And then on the 3800 XT, we get 3.9 all core, 4.7 single core. And then on the 3600 XT, you get 3.8 and 4.5. Now in terms of the architecture itself, nothing has inherently changed with the CCX clusters and CCD module. Basically with Ryzen 3000, you got 4 cores per CCX cluster and then 8 cores per CCD module maximum, and then 16 cores for a maximum on the AM4 platform with the 3950X. And with that, we see nothing changes on the 3800 XT, having 2 CCX modules on a single CCD, giving you 8 cores, 16 threads. And then moving over to the 3900 XT, we've got that split across 4 CCX clusters over 2 CCDs for a total of 3+3+3+3, which gives you 12 cores, 24 threads. Now the CCX latency is pretty consistent across the CPUs here, with the 3300X being the outlier on Ryzen 3000 chips. Since that is a single CCX design, there is no inter-CCX latency on this particular CPU, which does make it the king of some situations in games on the AMD AM4 platform. If you want to check out my overclocking video on that, I'll put the link up here. Though going back to the 38 and 3900 XT chips, I'm going to be comparing it against the current popular 3000 Zen chips out there and telling you guys why I think the 3800 XT may be worth a purchase, but perhaps not so much for the 3900 XT. Let's roll that intro and then talk about the benchmarks. So getting straight into the benchmarks, I'm only going to show the overclock numbers for the X versus the XT counterparts just to reduce the clutter. And basically it's just going to pertain directly to the recommendation here. And so we're seeing with 7-zip that we do squeeze out a bit more performance on both these XT chips. And when we overclocked the 3800 XT, it went up to a whopping 4.6 gigahertz, which to say the least is the highest overclock I have seen here for a Ryzen 3000 chip at the studio, even compared to that of the 3300X, which went up to 4.575 gigahertz. This was 4.6 gigahertz stable. I couldn't get any more out of it, but it was still good to hit that all core score. The move over to Cinebench, we can see here that the 3800XT follows in tandem with its overclocked differential versus the X counterpart, but the 3900XT does get an extra 125 megahertz, so not as much as the 3800XT gained over the X there. And even though that I could boot in at 4.55 gigahertz, it just presented the problem of it would only max out at 4.475 gigahertz, and this was the most I could get out of it. So the overclocks, basically when we look at it on the 12 core versus the 8 core, the 8 core that we've got in here is overclocking very well, and it's overclocking better than the 12 core in comparison, even though the out of the box scores show a bigger difference on the 12 core. But moving through Geekbench 5.1, we can see here that the 3900 XT and also the 3800 XT had some very impressive single core boosts out of the box. I was actually very impressed with the 3800 XT going up to around 4.75 gigahertz single core, and I did indeed validate this with Cinebench R20 when I ran the single core boost in that. It seemed to fluctuate between 4.6 and 4.75 on both the 3900 XT and 3800 XT. So they're pretty much programmed with that same boost that you see, but it's good to see that you're at least getting that advertised 4.7 gigahertz on the box coming out in real effect, whereas opposed to the 3900X, when I initially reviewed that, it wasn't really going near that box score, but it seems like a lot of updates later, it is getting a bit more performance, but it's still not performing as good as the XT counterparts. But moving over to V-Ray, we've got the multi-core scores here, moving in sync with the previous three benchmarks we showed here. And then continuing on to W Prime 2.1, we can see here that the multi-thread overclock is winning out both on the 32M and 1024M scores, which means that when we move on to the gaming benchmarks, I will say that I do prefer manually overclocking these XT chips as opposed to originally with the 3900X and the 3700X that I had for review, and then later I got a 3800X. I just preferred putting them on out of the box settings where they ran really well, but I feel like there's a bit more to be gained out of manually overclocking. And we'll start with Warzone here, because this is important to see that when you've got the precision boost out of the box, or just default settings, when I put it into my motherboard, boot it up, and lock in 3600 megahertz XMP profiles, which is what we used here today, CL16, we can see that the multi-core boost sort of doesn't know which level it wants to sit at. On the 3900 XT, it's going between 4.25, 4.3 gigahertz, and then on the 3800 XT, it's sort of bouncing between 4.4 and 4.5 gigahertz. Needless to say, it did score some impressive numbers in Warzone on both the 3800 XT and 3900 XT. There was virtually no difference between overclocking and leaving it out of the box on this particular game, though it is important to note that the 3800 XT did beat that of the 3900 XT, mainly due to it having a higher all-core boost to begin with. The move to Fortnite, we saw these CPUs trade blows, but it's something that I'm noticing is when you manually overclock the CPUs, they do fare quite a bit better than they would with a out-of-the-box precision boost. So perhaps precision boost can't read the game too well in this particular manner, and so manually overclocking and leaving your cores at a consistent speed gives you consistently better FPS. And then the last title we got up here is Shadow of the Tomb Raider with SMAA turned on, and the overclock on the 3800 XT did score a big victory out of the 3800 XT's precision boost out of the box. The 3900 XT virtually scored the same, with the overclock getting a slight 1 FPS advantage, but nothing to write home about. So summarizing those results and now giving you guys a recommendation, I think that the 3800 XT is definitely worth consideration with its very aggressive precision boost overdrive, which I will point out quickly the TDP figures where we went up to 140 watts out of the box. AMD did state in the reviewer's guide they would prefer us to turn off the precision boost, but one thing I know is that if motherboard manufacturers, Asus, MSI, Gigabyte, ASRock, if they're all selling these boards with that stuff turned on by default and it works really well, and I think it does work really well, then I'm gonna test it as such. And so I saw the 3800 XT boosting to some really healthy levels out of the box, healthier than that of a 3800X, and then beating that of the 3700X. So it was a really nice CPU for someone who wants to go with AMD and get the best FPS possible in games. Keep in mind the 3300X in certain situations may be slightly better, but for what it's worth, I think this with its 8 cores, 16 threads, who don't mind spending an extra $100 or so over the 3700X, but also are bringing their own cooler to the table and they don't mind losing out on the Wraith Prism. So overall, the value really isn't there, but you are getting that top-notch performance in games with the 3800 XT. So I think if you want to go with enthusiast overclocks for games and even stream where you're using the GPU encoder, then this CPU is going to deliver. Just keep in mind, it's not going to be the best value for money that AMD is offering. The last up here, we got the 3900 XT, and I feel like this is not as appealing as the 3800 XT. And in fact, I would recommend buying a 3900X over a 3900 XT, and the reason being was I didn't see as big as a performance differential as I did on the 3800 XT. But another big factor is the current pricing of the 3900X. In Australia, you can get this thing for 750 Aussie dollars with the Wraith Prism included, and you can get it in America for around 420 USD, which makes it hard to beat. I'd imagine the 3900 XT is going to come out close to MSRP and not include that Wraith Prism. And of course, you're only getting a bit more performance as opposed to the 3800 XT. You'd be saving $100 and getting better FPS in most games. So I feel like if you're going with the 12 core 24 thread option, you're doing so with value and productivity in mind, as opposed to the 8 core where you're doing it with more so the gaming focus in mind. So the 3900 XT really wins out with that value proposition. And I mean, lastly, with that said, the 3700X is coming in at currently 270 US. In Australia, you can pick it up for low 500 Aussie dollars, making that an exceptional value for money proposition. So ultimately, if you care about value for money, these two are not going to be it, but I do feel like the 3800 XT warrants itself as a good placeholder for someone who wants the best overclocks on the AMD side, and with that, of course, the best FPS from what AMD has to offer. Though with all that out of the way, do let us know in the comments section below what you think of the results of these two CPUs in today's review. Would you be interested in getting one or the other or none of them? Love reading your thoughts and opinions as always. Just like this question of the day here, which comes from AdNast, and they ask, Techia City, you say prices are going to come down. What sort of time frame do you foresee, as I want to build a system, but prices still seem very high? Where is the best place to buy new parts from online, or if you know anywhere in Adelaide to go to? So to answer that question, this is coming from someone who's in Australia. In Australia, the best place to buy PC parts is usually online. There's a few good retailers like Computer Alliance, Umart, PC Case Gear, MSY, and M-Wave, and they really give out some really good deals. There's also eBay with the 20% off sales in Australia. They offer some phenomenal value for money. So basically, when I make these predictions, they're usually around 3 to 6 months. That's when I feel the prices will really come down. And with that aside, if you guys enjoyed this one, be sure to hit that like button. Also, if you want to see more of the content the moment it drops here, be sure to hit that sub button, ring that bell, and share the video around if you like it. Share it to your friends if they're thinking about getting on AMD and they're getting the best FPS for their money. And I'll catch you guys in another tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.